Excited to be with you. I think it's only appropriate as we get started. Oh, is the mic on? Okay. As we get started this evening, Merry Christmas. It is a Merry Christmas. It's a great time of year. Even in the middle of 2020, Christmas has not been canceled. We have great reason to celebrate. Jesus Christ is born. We have hope in this world. We have hope in the life to come. And we've gathered to remember that and to celebrate that together this evening. Welcome everybody who is here. Join us in person. I'm the pastor, Rhett Carson. Welcome to those who are worshiping with us online. We're glad to be worshiping and celebrating this evening with you. A few announcements as we get started this morning. I always say morning because we usually worship in the morning, but as we worship this evening, a few announcements as we get started. First of all, I just want to say thank you to all the musicians who've worked hard, both and are going to be playing tonight. We've also had some musicians record some things earlier for us in this, that we'll be playing during the service. So thank you to Carol Pratica. Thank you to Christian and Callie Beamgard. Thank you to Judy and Sonia and Evan, Emily, Jane, everyone else who helped. And thank you for those who are running the sound booth and other equipments, and the deacons as well. It takes a village to even have a service, and I'm thankful for everyone who took part so that we can gather here to worship this evening. A few announcements for you guys this evening. First of all, I don't have an example in front of me. But hopefully everybody on the way in was notified to please pick up a packet. This is the communion packet we'll be using later on in the service as we observe the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. Real quick, there are actually two layers to this packet. There's a very thin, clear layer that takes you to take off first to get to the wafer. We'll take the wafer, then we'll have a brief moment, and then we'll go to take the juice, and you take off the thick foil layer to get to the juice. If you take off the foil layer first, you're in trouble because there's no way you're going to get that wafer out. So make sure you get the wafer out first. And make sure you take the thin little plastic layer to get to that inside, and we'll be taking part and observing that later on in the service. If you have any trouble while opening, we're going to have a song play and give a few moments to give everyone ample time to get into these packets. But if you have any trouble, we will have elders up front with gloves ready to assist you. If you need any assistance, just raise your hand at that time. Sadly, we were hoping to have a candle lighting outside tonight, but God had other plans, it looks, for us. It's raining, maybe even turning to snow tonight. We'll see. We should end in plenty of time to get home, everybody, safely. We are going to take one final look during the service, and if there's a break in the clouds, we will head outside to sing Silent Night together. If it's still raining, we're going to remain inside here in the sanctuary. Christians recorded Silent Night for us. But you are welcome at that time if you did bring a flashlight or a candle with you, or if you did bring your cell phone and you're techy enough to turn that flashlight on the cell phone. We will dim the lights and you can shine those as we listen to Silent Night inside. But weather permitting, we'll head outside. We'll make that announcement later on in the service. That's the announcements I have for the service. We're so glad you're here as we gather to worship. And let's prepare our hearts, minds, and souls for worship as we listen in silent to this evening's prelude.
Thank you.
Thank you, Judy. Thank you, Sonia. At this time, I'm going to invite my family to come and join me up front for the lighting of the Advent candle. We have practice, but when you got kids, you never know if everything's going to go according to plan, so we'll find out.
Why do we light up the candle?
On the eve of our Christmas celebration, Jesus' birthday, we light all of the candles of the Advent wreath. First, we light the candle for hope, because Jesus is our hope. Second, we light the candle for peace, because Jesus is our hope and peace. Third, we light the candle for joy, because Jesus brings joy. Fourth, we light the candle for love, because Jesus is love.
Finally, we light the center candle. This is the Christ candle. Jesus is born. Jesus has come. Jesus is our salvation.
Here's a reading from Galatians. But when the time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under law. Galatians 4:4.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, and we thank you, Lord, that we can gather together, Lord, to celebrate you, the greatest gift of all. We thank you, Lord, that you are God of love and light, and that you show that love and light so clearly to us, not just through the star that shone 2,000 years ago, but through the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. Oh, Lord, as we gather here, help us to focus upon you and to celebrate the birthday of our King and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's in his great name we pray. Amen. That may have gone better than practice, so. Well, some of them get their entertainment gene from their dad, I guess, so. As we continue to worship the Lord together this evening, we have Christian and Callie who've recorded for us Joy to the World.
Repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sound.
Thank you, Christian and Callie. This time, I'm going to turn to Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 20. I'm going to read to you the Christmas narrative as told to us according to the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 10, verses 1 through 20. This is God's Word. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria, and all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. And at the end of 8 days, when he was circumcised, he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. At this time, we have Carol Pratica, who's recorded for us a special music, pondering what Mary pondered, little one sleep.
Know of
Thank you, Carol. This time I'm going to turn to God's Word as we come before it this evening to remind ourselves of Christmas and the wonderful message that God gives to us. We have been going through a series on Sunday mornings where we've been looking at the message of Christmas by looking at the messengers of Christmas. So far, we've primarily been doing that by looking at the angels that God sent to proclaim His tidings and His revelations to certain people throughout the Christmas narrative. So we've looked at the angel's message to Mary, the angel's message to Joseph, the angel's message to the shepherds. But tonight I want to take a step back and ask us to realize that all we've talked about and focused on the angels as being messengers for God, the ultimate messenger at Christmas that has a message for us and for this world is God Himself. God is the Christmas messenger. He's the one that sent the angels to come and proclaim what they did to Mary, Joseph, and the shepherds. And tonight, I think we can also see that God also has an important message for us through Jesus Christ, His Son, as well. Jesus Christ was the Word of God incarnate. He was God in the flesh. And even by simply sending Jesus Christ into the world, God has a very important message that He wants you and me on all the world to know and realize. And we're going to be looking at that important message tonight. And to begin, I'm going to start by reading from John chapter 1, John chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. Hear now the reading of God's holy word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to bear witness about the light that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and yet his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen His glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness about Him and cried out, "This was He of whom I said, 'He who comes after me ranks before me, because He was before me.' For from His fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the only God, who is at the Father's side. He has made Him known." The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. Let's go to the Lord once again in prayer. Heavenly Father, we gather here this evening. We gather here in the midst of a world that, Lord, is suffering and conflicted, Father. We've been sent different messages. We have different things that are hindering us in our progress and our normal routines. But at the same time, as much as we might proclaim that this world is in darkness, there is light, and that light is Your Son, Jesus Christ. O Lord, allow that light to penetrate our hearts and minds this evening by Your Holy Spirit, so that we might hear what You would have us to hear, we might see what You would have us to see, we might celebrate what You would have us to celebrate tonight, tomorrow, every day of our lives, and for all of eternity. Guide us by Your Holy Spirit into the truth of Your Word, we pray, in the name of our great Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, as we mentioned earlier, we've been talking about important messages at Christmas, and if we have important messages for people at Christmas, one of the things that we often like to do is we like to send Christmas cards to people. We like to give them messages and communicate with them in that way and to give them special tidings, hopefully to give them updates and times of good cheer. But I have to admit to you, at least for me and my personality, I find picking out a Christmas card a terrifying ordeal. All you have to do is to walk into even Ingles down the road, and there are thousands of Christmas card options. How are you ever supposed to pick out just the right Christmas card? I know some people can walk in and just pick something out and put it in the mail, but if I'm trying to pick out that perfect Christmas card, that means I have to look at all 1,000 to find the best one of the entire match. And in case you don't know this, I would say, and this is Rhett, I didn't even find this on the internet, I would give you three criteria for the perfect Christmas card. If you're going to pick out the perfect Christmas card for someone, it needs to appropriately reflect the relationship that you have with that person. It needs to clearly communicate what you want that person to know. And also, it needs to come with a wonderful picture or image that goes along with that message. It has to reflect the relationship, it has to communicate clearly, and it needs an image to go along with it. If you find all three of those things, you found a good Christmas card. Buy it, put it in the mail, and bring some joy to that special someone. But as we are looking at the Christmas passage and looking at John chapter 1, as we're thinking about God being the messenger and Jesus Christ being his message and his word, as we look at that criteria for the perfect Christmas card, do you realize that Jesus Christ fits all those criteria? He checks all those boxes on the list. Jesus Christ is God's perfect Christmas card for us that we need this time of year, that we need to have in our lives. Let's look at that for a little bit together. First of all, does Jesus Christ reflect the relationship between us and God? Now, it's very important that when you're picking out a Christmas card that you go to the right section. I don't know if you know this, but the Christmas card section, they have different relationships. So they have one section if it's a brother, a sister, a child, a parent, a grandparent, an aunt, an uncle, a friend, a coworker. You have to go to the right section. I think there's even a pastor section out there. So you got to go and find the right section because it's very important that your message reflect the relationship. Because depending upon the relationship, what you're trying to convey, it tells you whether it's an appropriate thing to say, an appropriate way to say it. You need to have a clear understanding of your relationship with that person before you buy them a Christmas card. For instance, different messages will come across different ways depending upon what that relationship looks like. Don't believe me? Well, be very careful. Some relationships matter in the card that you're sending, and some things go well and some things go very poorly, simply depending upon the relationship. For instance, if you're sending a Christmas card to a coworker, it might be a great idea to have in that card, "Great job this year, keep up the good work." That would mean a lot to your coworker, but you probably don't want to include that in your message to your wife. "Great job this year, keep up the good work." You see, the relationship changes it, doesn't it? Also, you might say, it might be very appropriate if you have a child and you tell them, "Wow, look at how much you've grown this year." That's great to give your child, but once again, probably not the best thing to say to your coworker or your wife. "Wow, look at how much you've grown this year." Okay? The relationship changes it, doesn't it? Also, it's okay in some cards, if it's a card to your spouse, to say, "All I want for Christmas this year is you." That's great for your spouse, but probably not what you want to put in your coworker's Christmas card. The relationship directly impacts the message and how it is received. Well, what about Jesus Christ? What about God's message to us at this time of year? Does he reflect the relationship we have with God? Absolutely. What is that relationship that we have with God that's revealed in his word? Well, God's word, scripture, reveals that God is the great creator. He is the holy other. He is the omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent one who brought all things into existence, who began before even time was here and brought each thing into motion, including us, each and every person. He created us. We're told he knit us together in our mother's womb. We're told right now he knows the number of hairs upon our heads. He knows the plans. He knows our innermost thoughts. He is our great creator. And God created us to be in a special, intimate relationship with him as our Heavenly Father. That's our relationship with God. He's our creator, but he's our Father in heaven. But sadly, that relationship with our Heavenly Father has been broken. It has come undone. And not because anything that God has done, it is because of us. We who were supposed to be in this wonderful relationship with God, our Father in heaven, we have broken that covenant with him. We have gone our own way. We have pursued other relationships instead of him, and we have broken his law and his instructions. And so now we have become sin, and now we are no longer able to dwell in his presence as Adam and Eve did in the garden before they ate of the forbidden fruit. So we have this relationship with God as our creator and our Father in heaven, but it has been broken. And Jesus Christ reflects that relationship. Jesus Christ was sent not to a people in a perfect relationship with God, but to those who should have been in a relationship, but now that relationship was broken off. And God wanted to see that relationship once again restored. The message of Jesus Christ and God sending him to earth perfectly fits the relationship that we as a fallen people have with God. But let's go on. What was the other criteria I gave about a Christmas card? Not only did it need to reflect the relationship, it needed to clearly communicate the message that we want the other person to receive. We need to be very careful in our cards because we might unintentionally pick up a message or a card that says something in there that we didn't intend for it to say. We might just say, oh, this is a good deal. It's on sale. I can't believe I found this at such a great price. And we pick it up, but we don't look at the words closely. But sadly, it might say, instead of Merry Christmas, it might say, get well soon. Or it might say, Happy Valentine's Day. We have to make sure we've got the right message, a true story. We've got friends, it's actually my sister-in-law, the Griffins, who are down in Greenville, South Carolina. And she has three sisters, and a sweet church lady said, I'm going to send these girls all a Christmas card for their Christmas time. And they opened up their cards. The oldest daughter and the middle daughter, their cards both said, Merry Christmases. But the youngest daughter, her card said, My Condolences. She wasn't careful. She didn't look and make sure that the words matched up and clearly communicated what she wanted it to say. We need to be careful of that with the words that we use with others to make sure that we think through them and they clearly communicate. But God, in his message of Jesus Christ and sending him to earth, clearly communicates exactly what he wants us to know. What is that message? What is God communicating to us through sending his son, Jesus Christ, to us? His message in its simplest root form is this: I love you. The message of God sending Jesus Christ to earth at Christmas is God sending you and me in this world the ultimate love letter. This is even what Jesus Christ himself said just a few chapters later in John chapter 3, right? For God so loved the world that he sent his one and only Son. By sending Jesus Christ to earth, God was telling you and me that he loves us. And just think about that, especially as we reflect about the relationship we have with God. We have a relationship that should have been pure and wonderful and a delight to us, but we have broken that relationship. We have been unfaithful. And God has every right to despise us and to walk away from us and to treat us with wrath and contempt. But even in the midst of that, even before we apologize, God moves first, and he says, I love you. I love you so much that I want to see our relationship restored. I want to see us back together. And to show you how serious I am about this, I'm going to send my son, Jesus Christ, to earth for you because I love you. Because God realized that in his love for us, there was only one way for us to be made right with him again. And it was if someone came, a perfect child came, and took the penalty for our rebellion, took the penalty for our unfaithfulness, died the death that we deserved to die, and God sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be the substitute on our behalf so that God may once again have a right relationship with you and with me. And that's the message he sends to us at Christmas. Yes, Jesus Christ was born in Bethlehem, but he was ultimately sent here to earth to go to the cross at Calvary. Why would God do that for his Son? It was not because of what the Son had done. It was because God loves us, and he wanted our relationship to be restored, and this is the only way for that to happen. God sends us the ultimate Christmas message. It shows, just by sending his Son, Jesus Christ, that he understood the broken relationship, yet he still loved us so much that he sent his Son to earth to save us. He sent his Son into the darkness of this world. He sent his Son into the darkness of our sin so that he might be a light to this world and he might bring us into the light of salvation, to the light of truth, into the light of his kingdom for all of eternity. This is the message God sends to us at Christmas that we gather and celebrate. But there's one final criteria I gave you earlier. I talked about how the card, the perfect card, reflects the relationship. It clearly communicates the message that needs to be heard and received. But also, it's wonderful when we find that Christmas card that not only reflects the relationship, has that wonderful message, but has that great picture to go along with it. We spend a lot of time looking at those pictures, right? Because we want those to go along with the message. There's lots of picture options out there. We can go with the literal picture of our family and put that on the Christmas card. We can go with the beautiful drawing, maybe a beautiful drawing of a stable or a beautiful drawing of a shepherd or a star in the sky, and we can put that on our Christmas card to go along with the message inside. Or we can use the silly cartoon. We can use the cartoon of Grandma getting run over by a reindeer and put that on our Christmas card. There's different images that you can go, and all of them can be good or bad, but the real test about whether or not that image is right is, does it go along with the message you want this other person to know and to receive? And God does that for us as well through Jesus Christ and sending him to us on Christmas. It gives us an image that clearly communicates and supports what God wants us to know. We've already talked about a lot of the images we could talk about, how appropriate it was that Jesus Christ came to earth in the way that he came. God gave several ways to back up who Jesus was and what he came to do. We could talk about how Jesus came from the line of David. This showed that Jesus was a king and from royalty. We could talk about how Jesus was born of a virgin. That was a great sign because it showed that Jesus had come to establish a new line of descendants and a new covenant. We could talk about how, as we did last Sunday, Jesus was placed in a feeding trough, a manger, showing that he came to take on the filth of this world. We could talk about the sign and the image of the shepherds gathering at that stable to worship him. Shepherds who were the lowliest in Israel, to show that Jesus hadn't just come for the high and the elite. He had come for the poor and for the lowly. We could talk about the image of wise men coming from the east to come and lay down gifts for Jesus. Right then and there is another image that Jesus didn't just come for Israel. He came for all the nations and the people of the world. God gave great images to support Jesus Christ, who he was and what he came to do and his message for us. But the one I want to emphasize tonight is simply Jesus himself. Jesus himself being born in a stable is a wonderful image of the message God wants us to receive. Why do I say that? Because as we read in John chapter 1, Jesus is God himself. Jesus is God incarnate. He is God born in the flesh, God made man. And what do we see in that stable? We see God dwelling amongst his people. There is no divide. There is no separation. God is right there in their midst. Just Jesus being born shows us that God loves us and he wants to see the relationship restored. He doesn't want there to be a divide between us and him any longer. He wants us to be together. And that image of that child, of God himself, in helpless babe in the manger, shows us what God intends and desires and why he sent Jesus Christ in the first place. And it's amazing if you think about it just for a moment. God sent his son Jesus Christ to dwell amongst us for a little while here on earth so that one day we could go and live with Christ in God's kingdom forever with no divide, no sin, no death, no sickness, no sadness. God's dwelling will be with man, and man's dwelling will be with God forever. God clearly communicates to us through Jesus Christ and simply sending him to earth the most appropriate, beautiful Christmas card you will ever receive. It reflects our relationship and how we broke it and how we are estranged by God, but how God still loves us. And he loves us so much that he sent his son into the world to die for our sins so that we could be reconciled and we could dwell with God and he with us for all of eternity. This is the message of Christmas. God has spoken it to us. He has communicated it to us clearly. The only question, brothers and sisters, is have we received that message? Have we understood it? Have we recognized it for what it is and embraced it? Or have we instead written upon it, return to sender? What is it? Have you received God's message of love for you through Jesus Christ? Is that what you have come to celebrate today? And is that what you celebrate at Christmas? God's love, because that's why we celebrate this great holiday, is the love of God for us. That is the message we need to hear and receive. Brothers and sisters, I don't know if you'll ever find the perfect Christmas card for someone else. It might be a vain endeavor, but God has sent the perfect Christmas card to you with the perfect Christmas message, and it is his son, Jesus Christ. Receive that card, celebrate it, and yes, take that message, take that card, and share it with others as well. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this time together. We thank you that we have a reason to celebrate, Lord, in the midst of this world, in the midst of a pandemic, in the midst of people turning their own ways into their own devices, in the midst of sickness and hardship. We have hope and we have joy. Not because of who we are and what we have done, but in spite of what we've done, we have a God who loves us, who loves us so much he sent his son into this world so that we would not die, so that we would not perish, but could have everlasting life. Help us, Lord, to remember this message. Help us, Lord, to celebrate this message today, tomorrow, and every day and year to come in this world. And yes, Lord, in the next, when Jesus Christ returns and brings us to our true home. It's in his holy and precious name we pray. Amen. We're about to take part in the sacrament of the Lord's Supper this evening. We will be calling some elders forward to help and just be up here, but you should have your elements before. If you don't have those, you still have a chance to go out and receive those from the atrium, or we can probably have you come up front and pick one up from the trays here if you need those. But as we prepare ourselves for this time together, I do want to read to you our order of worship and let you know that this table that we come before is not my table. It's not the table of Pinecrest Church. This is the Lord's table. And I would invite anyone who is gathered here who has professed faith in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior to participate in, with us in this sacrament, this time of communion with our Lord Jesus Christ, by partaking of the elements of bread and juice with us. But however, I would also caution any of those who gather here together today who have not professed faith in Jesus Christ, who are not a member of His bride, the church, who are not endeavoring to live a life glorifying Him, I would encourage you actually to just let those elements reside. Just keep your packets closed, keep them there, leave them empty, and just choose this time to meditate upon what God would try to communicate you this Christmas season and what you believe Christmas is all about. And I tell you that to you because we're told in Scripture and we're warned in Scripture that those who come and partake of these elements without wisdom and without discernment will actually not receive a blessing, but will receive judgment from God. So please only partake if you have professed faith in Jesus Christ. But I would tell you, if you do partake, it's not out of your worthiness that you take these elements. It's because you recognize you were unworthy, but God loves you and has saved you through His Son, Jesus Christ. And so come boldly, profess your sins, and receive the grace of Jesus Christ, and participate with us in the glorious communion with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. As we prepare to take these sacraments, let's prepare our hearts and minds with God. This is also a great opportunity for worship, but also a great opportunity if you need to pray to God and confess anything at this time, use this time wisely as well. We're going to have Carol Pratica. She's also recorded for us an additional song, and it's Mary, Did You Know? So let's prepare ourselves to go before the Lord's table. Hear the words of institution of the Holy Supper of our Lord Jesus Christ as they're delivered to us by the Apostle Paul. For I receive from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let us pray. Gracious God, please pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and juice, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Jesus Christ to us. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast, united in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. O Lord, unite us together. Keep us faithful, Lord, in Jesus Christ till he comes in final victory, and we shall share the feast with all the saints in your kingdom at your table. We pray this all in the name of our great Lord and Savior, that great gift and message to us in his name, the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread. And after he'd given thanks, he broke it, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Take, eat. Do this in remembrance of me." Brothers and sisters, at this time, we'll encourage you to peel off the plastic section of your communion packet and receive the wafer. Jesus Christ is the bread of heaven. He is the one who God sent to bring us life. Take, eat. In the same manner, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Brothers and sisters, at this time, let's prepare to take the juice by peeling back the full section of our communion packet. Jesus Christ is the Word of God incarnate. He is the love of God incarnate. He is God sent to earth as a man to sacrifice his self upon the cross, so that by his blood we can be forgiven of our sins. Behold the blood of the Lamb shed for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take, drink. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you. We thank you that you have fed us in this sacrament. You have united us with Jesus Christ, our Savior, whom you sent to earth to save us from our sins. And you have given us a foretaste of that heavenly banquet in your eternal kingdom. O Lord, help us to treasure this union. Help us, Lord, to live according to this love and this forgiveness and this relationship that is ours with you, our great Father, and our Savior, Jesus Christ. And send us out, Lord, in the joy of this message, living according to it ourselves and sharing it with those around us so that, Lord, we would not only celebrate Christmas this one night, but we will celebrate Jesus Christ, this gift and our union with him every day here in this world and for all of eternity. It's in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Well, I was going to send Christian outside, but I believe I hear the rain. So we've got a negative negative. All right. So we're going to remain inside. Thankfully, we have the beautiful Christian and, well, the beautiful Callie and the beautiful voice Christian. Let me be careful about what I'm trying to communicate there. Who have recorded for Silent Night on the screen. So we'll be listening to that. We will go ahead and dim the lights. And if you like, if you have a flashlight or candle, or if you have your phone and you want to turn the flashlight on, we'll do our candlelight inside that way this evening as we listen to Silent Night on the TVs.
Holy infant, so tender and
EJ, you can go ahead and turn the lights back on. Brothers and sisters, it's been a delight gathering together and celebrate Christmas with you in person today. Also a joy to have anybody with us worshiping online. And we do truly hope that you have a wonderful and blessed Christmas time. And I think it's only appropriate to end by once again wishing you Merry Christmas. One note, I would ask that if you'd be so kind and help us by taking your empty communion packets, there will be trash cans located on your way out of the sanctuary. Look for one of those. That'll be a big help in cleanup after the service. I'll make my way out into the fellowship hall and greet anybody there who'd like to greet with me. But everyone have a blessed and safe holiday. Great to have you here.